I said that Dharma Vyada was a great hunter. I don't call him a butcher. Butcher has a different connotation altogether,
okay,
according to me. So Dharma Vyada was killing animals, and it was his profession, and he was also selling it, strictly following the rules and regulations of a hunter that have to be followed.
Okay.
So he became such a great person, and all the rishis used to come to him to seek some advice with regard to spirituality. That's what I said. So that means what happens? Very interesting thing is, nobody should aspire to become an acharya. That this person is qualified to become an acharya, or that person is qualified to become an acharya, is not the question.
So,
on the other hand, jnanam anushtanam ivai nannahave udayanana guruve adaindakkal, a person who has got jnana and anushtana alone is fit to become an acharya.
So, just sorry to, because this a phone call came and some interruption happened.
Okay.
The one statement that you made about nobody should become an acharya, and that one should, the God, something related to God, if you can just.
So, those persons who are chosen by God alone,
okay,
should become acharyas.
Okay.
And nobody should aspire to become an acharya. On the other hand, if it is chosen, if he is chosen by God, definitely he becomes an acharya, number one.
Okay.
And other important thing is, an acharya, what is the qualification of an acharya? Achinoti shastrani acharya sthapayatipi swayam acharateyastu saha acharyeti sprata. So he should be capable of extracting information from so many shastras, and he must have no doubts with regard to the teachings of the shastras, and he must know everything perfectly, and then he should be able to say, this is what the shastra says. And acharya sthapayatipi, he will also establish the achara, or the orthodox practices and principles, etc., etc., according to what he has received from his acharya and also what he has studied in the shastras. This is the second qualification. Third qualification is swayam acharate yastu. He should also practice whatever he preaches. If all three qualifications are there, then alone he is fit to be an acharya. Acharya doesn't appoint himself. There are so many self-appointed acharyas. On the other hand, acharyas have to be appointed by the shishyas. This is a very important point.
Yeah.
You cannot appoint yourself as an acharya. I am an acharya. Consider me as an acharya. No. So, that is one of the important things. And another interesting thing is, even when the acharya is giving initiation, etc., what should be in his mind? That's a very important point. I am initiating several people into Shivaishnavism. I belong to the family of Ananda Advan, who was one of the 74 Simhasanadipatis, actually nominated by Ramanujacharya. So we are entitled to initiate. Of course, we have come in that particular family tradition. But that doesn't make me an acharya.
Mm-hmm.
There was a discussion going on between my son and myself. I said, after my demise, you have to initiate people. Then my son asked, are we entitled? Have I got the Siddhi of Ashtaksha Mahamantra? How can I do it? Then I said, do you mean to say that I have got all the Siddhis? Then you may also put the question, can you initiate? Generally, what happens to keep up the tradition, because it has come in the family now, to keep up the tradition, what I have to do is, I have to do the initiation. I may get qualification, I have got qualification, whether I have got qualification, etc. People, other people have to say, let it be. But never I should feel that I am entitled to become an acharya. On the other hand, when I am initiating, what I should think is, through me, my father, who was my acharya, is initiating him. So if you once think that you are an acharya and these are your disciples, you swerve from the path of that acharyahood. It's a very important point to note.
You are saying we go away from the path.
Huh? Yes, definitely.
You should never say that
I have initiated such and such a person into this. On the other hand, you have to say, through me, I am just a showpiece, what should I say, I am just an instrument in the hands of my Acharya. Using me as an instrument, my Acharya has initiated him. You should always think like that.
Okay.
That is what Pillalokacharya has very clearly stated in his work.
What about the statement that I can read?
Yeah, the statement that says is, under no circumstances we as foreigners are qualified to be gurus.
No, I have not mentioned anything about the foreigners and other things.
But what is...
So you
have not mentioned anything about the foreigners and others. So because I don't want to enter into that particular controversy. So there's one interesting thing is there.
Yeah.
In the foreign country, Varnashrama Dharma has not been followed so far. Am I right or wrong?
My guru wants us to establish that.
He wanted to establish, but still he was not able to establish it completely, if I am right.
Yeah.
Day before yesterday, I was giving a lecture on Varnashram Dharma to 35 foreigners who have come from different parts of the world. I said, Varnashram Dharma is a very essential thing. What happens, Varnashram Dharma is a sort of genetic engineering. Scientifically, it is genetic engineering, nothing more than that. So they mention about Savarna Vivaha, that means a Brahmin marrying a Brahmin, a Shudra marrying a Shudra, etc., etc. Anuloma Vivaha, Pratuloma Vivaha, all these things they have stated. In the West, what has happened? I was teaching yoga to the Nathamunis Yoga Sampradaya to a person called Andrew, who has come from US. And he was asking me, when you say Varnashrama Dharma, what is Varna, you please, can you tell me? Because there is French blood in me, and there is German blood in me, and so many other bloods in me. I cannot define you.
Oh, okay.
That's what I said. So from that point of view, Srila Prabhupadaji tried one particular thing. According to your behavioral pattern, can I call you a Brahmana or a... Acharya used to, he was teaching Srivasham and also Bhagavad Vishnu to us, that is Thiruvamidi. And once some discussion came up like this.
This is still ongoing on.
Now, there are so many non-Brahmins in the Sri Vaishnava community.
Okay.
Who have studied many of the Sri Vaishnava works, and sometimes they are far better than Brahmins.
The quality is there.
Quality in the sense.
Brahminical quality.
Knowledge is concerned.
Okay.
As far as knowledge is concerned. So, they say, why you should not respect us just like Brahmin Acharyas? This question has come. Then, my Acharya used to say, once you climb it, you are unfit to be that. Because there is Ahankara in you. Because of that ego, you are claiming, I am superior to a Brahmin, etc. Whether the Brahmins are fit to be qualified as Acharyas or not, that's an entirely different question.
Mm-hmm.
So, on the other hand, what you do is, when you claim that you want to become an Acharya and you say, I am the Acharya because I have got so much of knowledge, etc., mere intellectual knowledge will not help you. In addition to that, what happens? The system should also might have changed or it might have been upgraded. All the Brahmins respect Damodar because he considers he is far superior to all the Brahmins now. This is a very important point to be noted.
So, Namalwar is from a fourth order.
Because though he was from the fourth order, as soon as he was born, he did not cry for milk. He didn't eat anything. So, the parents were helpless and they saw the child. It was not eating, it was not drinking milk, it was not doing anything, but it was growing every day. It was full of effulgence. What to do with that child? They just left it under a tamarind tree and went away. Is there any Brahmin who has not aspired for the milk of the mother? Who has not cried for the milk of the mother as soon as he was born? Though he was born as a Shudra, we consider him supreme. And we say he is the Prapadna Jana Kutastha, or the originator of the family of the Prapadnas, or the people who self-surrendered. So there are messages in all this very clearly.
He is Vishvakshena.
Okay.
Yeah.
But Avatara is just a feeling. That's exaggeration always.
Mm-hmm.
Because Namalvar himself has stated, Mari Mari Palapirappum Pirandu Adiya Adaindu Ullam Theri. I underwent several births, that's what he says. If he is Vishwachana, how can he undergo several births? When you say he is Vishwaksena, you are exaggerating, because when you see such qualities, you say, oh, he is almost like Vishwaksena, he is like Chakra, or he is like Shankha, etc. etc. There is a clash even in the Shivaishnavism, whether all the Alvars can be accepted as the avatars of Lord, etc. So many
Parshadams.
He is the avatar of Shankha, he is the avatar of Shankha, Chakra, etc.
Paraphernalia, Parshadams.
These are all just exaggerations, or we feel like that. Because when we see the qualities of such and such a person, if you accept that they are avatars, then there is no point in saying that they are the receptacle of natural grace of grass, God. Because they don't need the grace of God at all when they are born here. That is Dirhetaka Krapa Kataksha, we say that.
So to summarize this particular conversation, first of all, Gaura Keshava Prabhu's statement is not correct regarding what was stated, and you are also of the opinion that an acharya cannot proclaim or self-claim.
Self-proclaimed acharyas are not accepted.
At the same time, others see the qualities of acharyas as an example of Namalwa.
One thing I'll tell you, don't go according to the letter, go to the spirit of that.
Yeah. Okay.
What you have to do is, if a person is so much devoted and dedicated and he has got renunciation, will you not prostrate before him?
Well, but they'll say, what about the women? There are women like that.
Yeah. And what can we do?
So you can respect them, what is there. And women will not transcend their own limitations. That's the point. Namalvar did not initiate anybody. He did not initiate anybody into that. These people claimed that they were his acharyas. That's all.
So women cannot proclaim.
Kanchipurna also, he didn't initiate.
Very interesting thing I'll tell you about Kanchipurna. I and myself and Venkatakrishna discussed about this. Venkatakrishna, you know?
Yame Venkatakrishna Swami.
That is my brother. He is my cousin.
Oh.
We discussed about it.
Okay.
Suppose Ramanacharya wanted to take the prasadam of Kanchipurna. He could not do that. You know that story.
Yeah. Yes, yes, we know.
But was it not possible to invite him again? Second day, he could have prepared the food and offered it to him. Then he thought that we should not actually violate the Varnashrama Dharma feeling. That's why God has not asked, given me the chance to take the prasad.
When he asked Varadaraj, Varadaraj said, you should go to Mahapurna.
Mahapurna, yes, you can get all the information, no problem.
Yeah.
But he could not take his prasadam. Is it not so? He could have done it next day. Mahapurna also did not want that Ramanacharya should take his prasadam because he belongs to the Vaishyavarna.
Mahapurna?
Yes, he belongs to Vaishyavarna.
But that was Kanchipurna who belonged for the
Kanchipurna. Kanchipurna, not Mahapurna.
Kanchipurna.
Kanchipurna. Mahapurna
was from a Brahmin family.
And he opined that he should.
But the two wives got into a.
Okay, that's a different.
Kanchipurna came from a higher class.
Did not want to give his prasadam to Ramanacharya, that's why he wanted to avoid that. That's why he came earlier and had the food and went away.
Yeah.
And once again Ramanacharya could have invited him, it's not so. Then he would never come, he understood that. And he also felt it is the will of Varadaraja that he should not partake the food which is taken by my Kanchipur. So that's how we have to understand things. They are all very subtle things.
I'm going to stop this at my side because it's running out.
Okay.
But this is still continuing if you want to continue.
Okay. It's up to you.
I think he answered the question and he answered.
Yeah.
So.
Nobody should proclaim himself as an acharya. That's a very important point to be noted.
Whether male, female, any varna, anyone.
Any varna.
So.
I cannot proclaim myself as an acharya if it is. If that responsibility is placed on me, I should never deny if I have to do that. That's it. So what I should do, because in my family, I have to keep up the family tradition. I am the first son and always the first son is expected to do that. My brothers and others are laukikas only. And my father had so much of concern about this, and he didn't allow me to study English earlier, and he said he will be spoiled.
Wow.
Nearly for 7 years I had discontinued actually.
That's a very good point, revelation.
No, he says, never you should go out of the tradition. So he had so much of concern. We had nearly 200 acres of land. And there was also a discussion. I was interested in agriculture. And my father and all my uncles were discussing. In our family, this is the only person. He should become the acharya. So to make him the acharya, whether should he go to agriculture or culture? Ultimately, my father said culture only, not agriculture. Let all the lands go. We have lost nearly 200 acres of land. I think your gentleman from this ISKCON. He is near Mahadevpura in Mysore. Just adjacent to that, I had 100 acres of land in Chennai. From Mahadevpura, it is just 1 kilometer or 2 kilometers.
Okay.
All those things are gone. Now, Krishna consciousness people have got some lands.
You mean Marupandit, right?
Yeah, ISKCON.
So, it is like that. This is a very subtle issue, you must understand that. And in another place, I will give you one interesting example. Thirumanshi Alvar was a Brahmin, but brought up in some other community. And he was also thinking that what happens, he was not a Brahmin at some sense. And there were some people who were reciting the Vedas, strictly according to the rules and regulations of Panini. And Thirumanshi Alvar came. Immediately they stopped the recitation. And the Shudra is around, you are not expected to recite, that's what they said. They stopped it according to the rules they had straight. Then Thirumanshi Alvar came there and he prostrated before the Brahmins and he went away. But Thirumanshi Alvar was more knowledgeable than these people. Very interesting point here. Then what happens? These Brahmins forgot the place where they stopped. And there was, when he was about to leave, these people were discussing where did he stop, etc., etc. Then nobody could say, because they had forgotten. Then Thirumanshi Alvar came back, he heard this, he came back and he brought a paddy corn and then he removed the husk of that. Then immediately these people understood. Tad vrihinam nakhanirbhinam was the statement.
He didn't want to utter it, but he just...
He didn't want to recite it because he was not entitled. Huh? He was not entitled, so he didn't recite it. On the other hand, he showed by his action. He removed the husk of a paddy and he said, you have forgotten this particular line. Is it interesting or not?
Yeah, it's they are very conscious of their, the system given by
then
Krishna.
I asked one question in some place. Suppose Nammalvar had one or two daughters and Ramanuja was also living at that particular time. Would he brought the daughter of Nammalvar to his house as his daughter-in-law or Sansati?
We don't know.
They will not do. Because Varna Dharma depends upon the physical body. What body you possess. Otherwise there is no Varna for Atman. Shundi Chayu Shubha Keita Panditas Samadarshina.
Varna is from material, it's a material consideration.
Yes, Varna is from the point of view of the system you possess, physical system.
Your body.
Your body. As long as you are in this particular body, you are not expected to do certain things.
And expected to do certain things.
Expected to know everything. I differ there again.
Okay.
Yesterday also there was a discussion, I am frequently entering into this discussion. Now, in our community, most of the non-Brahmins, they are also interested in studying Shiva Bhashyam, studying Gita Bhashyam, and also studying Vedas, etc., etc. He never teaches them. That's a, I have to give a big lecture about that. What we say is, why unnecessarily you are bothered about this? We can disseminate the entire information available in the Vedas to anybody. Do you want the information or do you want the body or do you want the soul? I can disseminate any knowledge available in the Vedas, Brahma Sutras, Gita Bhashya, Brahma Sutra Bhashya, etc., etc. to all the people. Because when we teach Nammalvar's Thiruvayamudi, We frequently quote from the Sri Bhashyam, frequently quote from the Upanishads and explain everything to everybody. So, everybody is having the right to possess that knowledge. But to possess the knowledge in the same manner as Brahmin possesses is not accepted. Because, according to me, the human system, the Brahmin system, the body a Brahmin possesses is a different system altogether. For that, I can give you hundreds of examples.
Yeah.
When Obama came to India, they had brought 9 dogs from America. Do you know that? Do you know that?
I believe you, but I can see that all the dogs must have multiplied when they're living in Bangalore.
Interesting article. They had brought 9 German shepherds and they had given wonderful training to that. If any security problems comes, they will take care of him carefully, and that's the thing. Immediately they will catch the other fellow who will try to kill him or something. For that, what they do is, they select the dogs. So, if a dog has to be selected for that training, 3 generations from the mother side and 3 generations from the father side, they will examine and say, all these belong to German Shepherd only. There is no mixing of blood, etc. And it's a thoroughbred animal. They assure that, and then alone they will give you training. If it is the case of dogs, can we completely transcend it? This is a natural phenomenon.
Okay,
I'll complete it.
Yeah.
So to study the Vedas as prescribed in the Shastras, you have to have a different system altogether. I don't know whether Brahmins are also qualified or not. That's my feeling. That's entirely a different issue.
In the Gurukul, the Dvijas were also Vaishyas and Kshatriyas.
I'll come to that.
Okay.
So, Brahmins are expected to learn the Vedas and teach the Vedas. Kshatriyas can learn the Vedas but not teach. And Vaishyas also can learn the Vedas but not teach. The Gurukul, all the 3 should be there. But only Shudra is not entitled to learn some. And there is also an Apashudra Adhikarana in Sribhashyam, where the Sudras are also entitled to get only a few portions. I will tell you about that. Let it be. So, Brahmana has got the Dana and Pratigraha, both of them he can do. He can give something in charity, he can also receive. Kshatriya cannot receive, he can give. And only Vaishya can give and not receive. These 3 people are. Adana, Pratigraha, both of them, Dana and Pratigraha, both of them can be done by Brahmana only. That's what has been stated. To have this particular qualification, do you know how many rules are prescribed with regard to the Brahmin? When we initiate a student into Gayatri Mantra or to the Vedas, we prescribe so many qualifications. He must say yes, 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 immediately he must say om, 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 etc. What is that? Masushuptaha. You should not sleep on a cot or bed. You have to sleep on the floor. And in the mornings you are not expected to sleep. And you should not overeat. You should not. So many qualifications have been prescribed. So my feeling is it is just like a supercomputer, the Brahmin's body. So if he keeps it clean, then alone he is entitled to study the Vedas. If he eats garlic and if he eats onions, etc., he is worse than a Shudra.
Onion gars.
Yes. He is worse than a Shudra.
More in their butter. Because I live in a Sri, and I anger Agrahayana there. But they are also eating onions and garlic.
They are also eating eggs. They say they are vegetable eggs.
I know. So the
all this nonsense. How they are entitled to study Vedas?
Murindar Bhattar Ashivangam. He came to my
house. So everything is so much vitiated now. It is very difficult to say this is the right thing and this is the wrong thing. With regard to that, what I said is nondescript. I will tell you. If several crossings take place. Suppose I have got a jersey cow. Tomorrow I will cross it with Halikar. Halikar and jersey cow is a mixture of these 2 is born. Then in the next generation I cross it with Gir. In the next generation I cross it with Tharparkar. Then fifth generation or sixth generation, what it is? It is a nondescript.
Varna
Sankara has taken place, it is a nondescript. So in the West, since this Varnashrama Dharma was not followed for a long time, so there is so much of Varna Sankara, what to do? That's why Srila Prabhupada tried to say, at least by understanding your personal behavior and also studying your behavioral pattern and also the qualities you have, I can say you belong to this category or this category. That's a very important thing to be noted. I'm not saying it is again, I'm not against it. But in the West, it was not so systematized. Our society was so systematized. Now we are following the West. Already, I generally ask my family, some people come to me and give invitations and they invite me to marriage. I'll say, is it an exception or general rule? Mm. What is exception, do you know? If Iyengars marry a Shudra, it's a general rule according to me, no.
No, yes.
If Iyengar marries an Iyengar, then it's I exception. Say, this is exception.
And through the traditional method of horoscope matching. That is a different
thing altogether.
Yeah.
First of all, what has happened? Most of the Iyengar girls are marrying so many Shudras and other people. And it is genetic engineering. I say, I have studied Brahma Manasarma Shastra and that he has beautifully stated how to create human resources for the country. What type of human resources you require? So whether a Kshatriya, whether a Brahmin should marry a Kshatriya and get a child, that child will be what happens. He will have the, both the characteristics of a Kshatriya and also a Brahmana. If he is a pure Brahmin, what happens? Have you studied, have you not come across the story of Karna?
Yeah.
Suppose in place of Karna, there is a Brahmin. Could he withstand that pain when the bee was boring his thigh?
No.
He could not have. That's why immediately when Parashrama awakened, immediately he said, you are not a Kshatriya, you are not a Brahmin. Immediately he said.
Right.
He knew that only a Kshatriya can withstand that much of pain.
True.
So there is a message in that.
Yeah.
Okay, then I have got some other work.
I know.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.